Let's take a look at a segment of DNA that's in the process of being replicated. And I want to focus in particular on the enzyme that replicates DNA. And that enzyme is DNA polymerase. And actually, there are a few different types of DNA polymerases, and the one that we're looking at right now is DNA polymerase 3. So DNA polymerase 3 synthesizes new DNA, and it also has the ability to proofread, or kind of check the DNA that it's putting together and make sure that there are no mistakes in it. But before we get into that, let's just orient ourselves and quickly summarize the diagram that we're looking at. So this enzyme over here is DNA helicase. That's the enzyme that unwinds the double-stranded DNA so that DNA polymerase can then come in and start replicating. Right over here, you can see I drew the backbone in a different color. That's the RNA primer. Now let's just label the DNA strand that's being synthesized. It's synthesized from 5 prime to 3 prime. And actually, the bottom strand of DNA is synthesized in the same time as the top strand, but I just left that out of the drawing to keep things simple. And let's say that the yellow bases represent the nitrogen-based thymine. Let's say that the orange bases represent cytosine. The green ones represent adenine. And the blue ones represent guanine. And so thymine and cytosine are the pyrimidines. They are composed of a single ring structure. So they're made up of one ring that has 6 sides to it. And then adenine and guanine are the purines. They are a double ring structure. So they're composed of one ring with 6 sides to it, and then that ring is attached to another ring that has 5 sides to it. And actually, the structures are a little bit more complex. There are other atoms, you know, in it, and there are some double bonds, but we're just going to keep things simple for now and leave it at that. And so let's get back to our DNA that's being replicated. Right over here, I left a space. I didn't put the nucleotide in. And let's say that by accident, instead of it being paired up with the proper base, which is adenine, it accidentally gets paired up with a guanine. So that's a mistake. And DNA polymerase 3 actually has the ability to sense if it made a mistake. And if it does realize that, it's going to go backwards, and it's going to actually remove the incorrect base and replace it with the correct base. So let's do that. It's going to remove the incorrect base and replace it with the correct one. Of course, remember the nitrogen base is attached to the sugar backbone. And so this activity that I just described to you is called exonuclease activity. And so nuclease tells us that means the ability to remove a nucleotide. And exo, just going to underline that. So exo tells us that it can remove a nucleotide, but only from the end of a DNA strand. So it was able to remove the nucleotide because it was at the end of a strand. This is in contrast to endonuclease activity. So an endonuclease can actually remove a nucleotide from the middle of a DNA strand. So it would be able to remove, I don't know, a nucleotide from like right over here, for example. And just keep that in mind because we're going to come across some endonucleases as well. Anyway, back to our exonuclease activity. If we want to be more specific, the exonuclease activity of DNA polymerase 3 is actually 3 prime to 5 prime exonuclease activity. And the reason it's called 3 prime to 5 prime exonuclease activity is because when DNA polymerase 3 makes that correction, it has to move backwards in the 3 prime to 5 prime direction in order to do that. There's another enzyme, DNA polymerase 1. I'm just going to abbreviate polymerase with POL. And DNA polymerase 1 also has exonuclease activity. And DNA polymerase 1 is actually the enzyme that will remove the RNA primer at the end of replication. And just as a side fact, the exonuclease activity of DNA polymerase 1 is actually in the 5 prime to 3 prime direction. So if you want, you could just keep that in mind. And so DNA polymerase 3 and DNA polymerase 1 are both able to repair or fix mistakes that happen during DNA replication. And just to give you some perspective as to how often this occurs with and without repairs. So normally we'll have a mistake happening in replication between 1 in 100,000 bases to 1 in 1 million bases. That's normally the amount of mistakes that would occur. But with the repair mechanisms of DNA polymerase 3 and DNA polymerase 1, this is reduced to a mistake that happens once in about 100 million bases. And so they are very, very effective at lowering the error rate in DNA replication. So the next question I want to ask is, what if this mistake over here was somehow not corrected during replication? Maybe there was something wrong with one of the enzymes, something happened and that mistake was actually sustained. So let's take a look at that. So here's a piece of DNA with our mistake incorporated into it. And so before we discuss if this mistake can be corrected or not, let's see what happens if this mistake is not corrected. So right here we have our original DNA, and we're replicating it. And let's just say that this strand over here is the same as that strand. Let's say that the bottom strand in our original DNA is the same as this strand. And so let's look first at the newly replicated DNA on the left. So we have right over here a thymine base, and assuming DNA was replicated properly, it's going to have an adenine complementary to it. Now let's take a look at the DNA on the right. So on the bottom we had a guanine, and it's going to be paired up, hopefully with the correct base, which is a cytosine. Now let's just quickly look back at our original DNA. We were supposed to have a thymine with this complementary adenine. And actually, that's exactly what we got over here. Just gonna circle it. So this DNA is actually in the correct sequence. But look at the DNA over here on the right. This is not correct. This is a mutation. And this is an example of how mutations can occur if the DNA repair mechanisms are not working properly. And so let's go back to our original question. Can we fix the original mistake so that this mutation does not occur? And the answer to that question is yes. So fortunately, our cells have what's called the mismatch repair mechanism. And the mismatch repair mechanism is composed of a number of proteins. And the first thing these proteins are going to do is they're going to recognize if there's a problem. And the reason that they're able to recognize the problem is that when you have a mismatch in DNA, it tends to distort the sugar backbone a little bit. And they're going to mark the area with a cut. So they're going to cut the incorrect base or mark it with a cut. The next thing that's going to happen is an exonuclease is going to remove the incorrect nucleotide. So we're going to remove the incorrect nucleotide. The next step is one of the DNA polymerases is going to insert the correct nucleotide. So we're going to pair our thymine up with adenine. And the last step is a DNA ligase is going to connect the new nucleotide to the nucleotides on its sides, and also to its complementary nucleotide on the other strand. And I'm actually going to just correct that distorted sugar backbone. And so here's our repaired DNA. And just to clarify, the mismatch repair mechanism that we're talking about here happens after replication. The repair is done by DNA polymerase 3 and DNA polymerase 1 that we discussed before. That happens during replication or at the end of replication. And so one thing you might be wondering is, how does the mismatch repair mechanism know to distinguish between the original parental strand and the newly synthesized strand that has the mistake on it? In other words, how does it know which base over here is correct? In our case, that's the thymine, and which one is incorrect? In our case, well, it was a guanine. And we know the answer to that question in bacteria. So in bacteria, the parental strand will have adenines that are methylated. So I'm just going to draw some methyl groups on all the adenines. And that allows the mismatch repair mechanism to kind of recognize and distinguish between the original strand that has the correct base on it and the new strand that has the incorrect base on it. But we're not quite sure how the mismatch repair mechanism in eukaryotic cells and in other prokaryotic cells knows to distinguish between the strand that has the correct nucleotide and the strand that has the incorrect nucleotide.